Embracing Defeat by John W. Dower. The book is subtitled Japan in the Wake of World War II. For Howard B. Schoenberger, 1940 to 1991, who never lost sight of the ideals of peace and democracy. Acknowledgements. This book has taken a long time to prepare and would have taken forever without great contributions from two people. My wife, Yasuko, helped to survey a broad range of materials, and our conversations, woven into the fabric of everyday life, became an important way of mulling over themes and probing nuances. We covered a great deal of ground together, not only figuratively, exploring the past, but also literally in various places in Japan and the United States. This is a heavy debt, as well as a rewarding way to do history. At a certain point, these labors came together in an exceedingly long manuscript, and I called on an old friend to help me get untangled. Tom Engelhart responded with patience and an exceedingly sharp pen. His critical scrutiny extended beyond language to structure, and beyond structure to themes and concepts. The manuscript reads differently, and faster, because of his friendship and skill. I am indebted to others as well. Sode Rinjiro, General MacArthur's Japanese biographer and a master of knowledge about occupied Japan, has directed me to many Japanese materials. My reliance on some of his writings, especially his analysis of letters written by ordinary Japanese to MacArthur, is obvious here. Ever since a long sojourn in Kamakura early on in this project, I have turned to Aketagawa Toru to track down Japanese sources. I also shared materials with Herbert Bix and had numerous helpful conversations with him about the role of Emperor Hirohito. Takao Toshikazu directed me to one of the most remarkable texts I have introduced here, the diary memoir of Watanabe Kiyoshi. Alex Gibney shared transcripts of some of the excellent interviews he conducted concerning the American drafting of a new Japanese constitution. Murakami Hisayo called attention to interesting materials in the Gordon Prang collection of Japanese publications submitted for vetting by the occupation's censors and now housed in the McKeldin Library at the University of Maryland. It was she who showed me what I regard as a little gem, the 1946 cartoon history of the occupation by Kato Etsuro. James Heisig made me aware of Tanabe Hajime, the formidable nationalistic philosopher of repentance. James Zobel at the MacArthur Memorial identified a number of important archival documents. Years ago, when I began exploring Japan's transition from war to peace, I had the good fortune of being associated for a year with the Post-War Financial History Project of the Japanese Ministry of Finance, headed by Hata Ikuhiko, and I still ride on some of the materials collected then. One summer, Yasuko and I secluded ourselves at Farm Island Lake in Minnesota and did economic policy in a cabin generously made available to us by Jerry and Aiko Fisher. I also received advice, materials, or assistance from Takemaya Eiji, Matsuo Takayoshi, Sumiya Mikio, Igarashi Takeshi, Yui Daizaburo, Koseki Shoichi, Kato Yasuhara Yoko, Miura Yoichi, Eiji Yutani, Yuki Tanaka, Koji Amemiya, Laura Hine, Marlene Mayo, David Swain, Frank Schulman, Andy Coopersmith, Peter Grilly, Edward Friedman, Glenn Fukushima, and Steve Rabson. At the Massachusetts Institute of Technology, student projects by Abigail Vargas, Jennifer Mosier, and Ann Torres helped illuminate aspects of the Japanese scene immediately after the war. Leslie Torrance typed several chapters. Diane Brooks and Mabel Chin were of unfailing help in navigating the practical world, and in various ways the university administration generously supported my research. At one point early on, our daughter Kana turned some handwritten chapters into computerized ones. Ed Barber and Andre Schifrin have been my patient mentors at W.W. Norton and the New Press, respectively, and Georges Borchardt has been my literary agent. Barbara Gurr copy-edited the manuscript. Sarah Holt and Alan Tolliver at Boston's WGBH television station shared photographs collected for a documentary on General MacArthur. Funding that has supported the project has come from the Japan Foundation as well as MIT. On several occasions, Tokyo University generously extended institutional access to its facilities. Japanese publications pertaining to Japan's defeat in World War II and the American-led occupation that followed defy counting. They include excellent archive-based academic studies and an extraordinary range of edited popular volumes containing articles published at the time, letters written to newspapers during the occupation, day-by-day chronologies, photos, capsule summaries of films, song lyrics, special topics like the war crimes trials and the black market, lists and summaries of post-war bestsellers, what have you. I have drawn heavily on such published Japanese materials, and on certain subjects I have taken it as my task to present some of the findings of Japanese scholars to English language readers. These scholars deserve special mention here. On war crimes, exceptional research and analysis have been done by Awaya Kentaro, Yoshimi Yoshiaki, Yoshida Yutaka, and Onuma Yoshiaki. Koseki Shoichi has published the most incisive scholarship on the Japanese side of constitutional revision. The expert on popular magazines of the early post-surrender period, especially the pulps, is Fukushima Juro. He is a major source for my treatment of this lively subject. On scap censorship, I have drawn many examples from the writings of Furukawa Atsushi, Eto Jun, and Matsuura Sozo, among others. Where Japanese films of the immediate post-surrender period are concerned, the invaluable benchmark study is in English, by Kyoko Hirano. A note on Japanese names. Throughout the text, I have followed the Japanese convention in which the family name or surname precedes the given or personal name. Thus, for example, Prime Minister Yoshida's full name is Yoshida Shigeru. Of necessity, however, this rule is reversed in two situations, where Japanese living outside the country have chosen to follow the opposite, Western, order, and in identifying the authors of publications in English. Introduction. Japan's emergence as a modern nation was stunning to behold. Swifter, more audacious, more successful, and ultimately more crazed, murderous, and self-destructive than anyone had imagined possible. In retrospect, it seemed almost an illusion, a 93-year dream become nightmare that began and ended with American warships. In 1853, a modest fleet of four vessels, two of them coal-burning black ships, had arrived to force the country open. In 1945, a huge, glistening armada came back to close it. When all this began with the arrival of Commodore Matthew Perry, Japan was a small country with few obvious resources. For over two centuries, intercourse with foreigners had been largely prohibited by its feudal shoguns. Although the economy had become commercialized in those long years of seclusion, no industrial revolution had taken place, nor had there been any striking advances in science. If Americans and Europeans found these island people capable and clever as well as exotic, no one thought to say of them, as Napoleon had of neighboring China with its vast territories, its awesome population, and its millennia of high civilization, that here was a sleeping giant. In 1868, dissident samurai drove out the shogun and established a government in the name of the emperor, hitherto a remote, powerless figure. Their new nation-state proved a quick study, learning the modern arts of war as well as peace, and showing itself particularly adept at understanding how to survive in an imperialist world. As a line in a popular Japanese song of the 1880s put it, "There is a law of nations, it is true, but when the moment comes, remember, the strong eat up the weak." While most of the rest of the world fell under the control of the Western powers, Japan emulated them and joined their banquet. In 1895, the Imperial Army and Navy brought China to its knees. This decisive victory on the Asian mainland, capped by an enormous indemnity, precipitated a scramble for international concessionary areas torn from the very body of the sleeping giant. Slicing the Chinese melon was the pleasant way Westerners came to speak of this. The war brought Imperial Japan its first colony, the island of Formosa. Triumph over Tsarist Russia 10 years later, after costly battles on land and a sensational victory at sea, gave the nation an internationally recognized foothold in Manchuria, and paved the way for taking Korea as a second colony. Loans raised in New York and London helped to finance this war, and the Western powers turned a deaf ear to the appeals of Korean patriots. In World War I, Japan joined the hostilities.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.